Penguin Random House Audio presents The Last Arrow, Save Nothing for the Next Life. This is the author, Erwin Raphael McManus. Like arrows in the hands of a warrior, are children born in one's youth. Psalm 127:4. To my arrows, Aaron Christopher McManus, who has never backed down from a fight, and to Mariah McManus Goss, who is as fearless as she is fierce. Long after I rest my bow and have struck my last arrow, there will still be arrows flying true. Their names are Aaron and Mariah. The trajectories of their lives will take them far beyond the ground I have taken. If they were once my arrows, they are now my archers. I dedicate this book to them and the future they represent. Aaron and Mariah, you are the tip of the spear. You are the future. This is your fight. I pulled the bow back as far as I could and gave you all the strength I had to send you into flight. Fly far and true. Cross enemy lines. Hit the mark. Set captives free. Keep striking until the battle's won. Dad. Preface. The Battle. It was Thursday, December 15th, 2016, when I sat across from the desk of my doctor and heard him say the words we hope to never hear. You have cancer. The science had been there for years, but the news was still unexpected. There just isn't much you can do to prepare for that situation. The moment felt surreal to me. It was as if it were happening to someone else. I was an uncomfortable bystander, awkwardly peering into someone else's life. What shook me into reality was to see the shock and pain in the eyes of my wife, Kim, as those words sank into her soul. Watching her made the reality of it all much too real. Sharing this news with our kids only made the pain deeper and the sorrow felt like oceans. The doctor went on to explain that I would need an MRI and a bone scan to determine the extent of the cancer. It would need to be determined whether the cancer had spread to my bones and vital organs. The biopsy returned malignant in 5 of the 8 areas that were tested. I was told it was important for us to move quickly. The radiation specialist informed me that surgery was our best option. Afterwards, we would know the process and extent of treatment. We love Christmas, and all of this fell into our lives days before our favorite holiday. It was a heavy holiday season mixed with joy and sorrow. We were all too aware of the temporary nature of life and how precious every moment is that we are given. It was on the same day that I learned my diagnosis that I opened my manuscript to finish my final edits of this book. It could not have been incidental that the first line I read was one I had written nearly a year earlier. Before you hear it from someone else, I need to tell you that I'm dying. I could not believe I was reading these words. I could not believe I wrote them. It was as if my words were written after the day's news, not before. I had to wonder if my words were more prophetic than intended. It caused me to begin to read my manuscript with a deeper and greater clarity than when I wrote it. It seems strange to say, but I was moved by these words I had written. I spoke of life and death and what it meant to live without fear or regret. I spoke as a man who knew he was going to die. Now facing the prospect of death, I only felt these words more deeply. I am writing this preface of The Last Arrow to tell you just that. I mean every word I have written, even in the face of death, especially in the face of life. I finished this book wondering if it would be my last arrow. I know one thing for certain. I am not saving anything for the next life. I am the pastor at Mosaic. And on the last Sunday before I went in for surgery, I gave a message that expressed my posture going forward. It was simply titled, Battle Ready. I made a decision that while cancer may define how I die, it would not define how I live. Life is a series of challenges, adventures, and yes, even battles. There will always be giants to subdue and dragons to slay. I have already decided to die with my sword in hand. There is more courage in us than danger ahead of us. You are strong enough for the battles ahead. My intention for this book is that you would never surrender, that you would never settle, that you would save nothing for the next life. May you die with your quivers empty. May you die with your hearts full. Chapter 1. The Point of No Return. William Osborne McManus married my mom when I was around 3 years old. He wasn't my birth father. He never legally adopted me or my brother. But for all intents and purposes, he was the only father I ever knew. We became close, and I imagine that in my childhood, I loved him as much as any son could love a father. When I was young, I called him Dad. Later in life, I simply called him Bill. This man was a contradiction in every way. He was warm and engaging, charismatic and winsome. At the same time, he was a con man for whom truth was simply material woven into whatever lies he needed to tell. I remember when the movie Catch Me If You Can, starring Leonardo DiCaprio, came out. My brother Alex called me up and said, "Have you seen the movie? It's Dad." I had the exact same thought when I sat in the theater watching the movie. If you want to understand my childhood, it's summarized for you in 2 hours. Over the years, Bill caused my family deep pain, callously disregarding my mom and my 2 little sisters, the daughters he had fathered. By the time he left us, when I was 17 years old, all the love I had felt for him had turned to disdain. That day, he must have seen what I was feeling and thinking when he looked into my eyes, because he moved toward me aggressively. And while my instincts made me want to step back in fear, my anger made me hold my ground. Standing face to face with me, he said, "Hit me. I know you want to. See if you're man enough." I looked at him and said, "You're not worth the effort." He got in his car as my little sisters begged me to find a way to reconcile. I went outside to plead with him not to leave. My last memory of him from that day was seeing his face on the other side of the windshield when he clipped me with the front of the car as he drove away. Even after that fateful day, we did find a way to reconcile and stay in touch by phone, although our contact was minimal. But there is truth to the adage that what has been torn cannot be mended. Eventually, Bill remarried, and around that same time, I married as well. As if it were a script, his new wife and my wife, Kim, were pregnant at the same time. But for more reasons than I can explain, I made the hard decision of leaving my stepdad in the past and focusing on building a future for my family without Bill as a part of our lives. Before I knew it, 15 years had passed, years in which Bill and my son Aaron never met. Aaron was the first true McManus in our family. I had taken the name McManus from Bill without his ever legally becoming my father. And ironically, McManus wasn't even his name. It was an alias he assumed. He was the kind of person who was always running from his past, and his false identity was a part of that. Finally, Aaron came by the name legitimately. When Aaron was 15, he wanted to meet the man who gave me that name in the first place, the man I called my father. I felt I owed him that. So even though I hadn't spoken to my dad in 15 years, I tracked him down as if he were a stranger I was trying to meet for the first time. We found him in a small town outside Charlotte, North Carolina, called Matthews. He was more than happy to see me and more than happy to meet my son. I think I had caused him great sadness by extricating myself from his life for the past 15 years. I didn't know what to expect, but the reunion went well enough for a while. Then there were these last words I heard him say as we were leaving. Not just the last words that day, but forever, as he died not long afterward. He said to my son in my presence, "I don't know what your dad has told you, but he was average. He was just average. His brother was exceptional, but your dad, he was just average." Those words cut me like a knife. Please don't misunderstand me. What hurt most was not that those were the last words my father chose to say about me, nor was I most hurt because my son heard this judgment. What cut me deepest was a terrifying sense that Bill McManus was right, that I was just average.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.